Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 19 of Gen X Jukebox. I am Darren Grantham, your co-host, and joining me is Rob Meyer. How are you, sir?
I am not too shabby.
Wonderful news.
Yeah.
All right. So, in this episode, we're going to be talking about the year 1982 and the music that we got from that year. A couple of points of interest also from that year. That was the year that Ozzy Osbourne bit the head off of a live bat.
Was
in
it?
in his concert in Des Moines, Iowa. Yes, that was the year that he did that. It's also the year that we got the television show Cheers, E.T., nice. The movie E.T., the video and song Thriller from Michael Jackson.
Early in the 80s, really?
Yeah. Also, Toto's Africa came out that year. The movie, I already said E.T., we got the movie Blade Runner and Tron. I'm sorry, what song did I say from Prince?
You didn't say anything from Prince.
Oh, Little Red Corvette came out that year. The popular toys. Let's see, what do we have? Well, CD players were introduced in 1982.
In 1982 already?
Yeah, the Commodore 64. Diet Coke was introduced as well as Bud Light. Your favorite, and I think you still wear this, Drakkar Noir.
I fucking hate Drakkar.
I know, but G.I. Joe toys came out. Ms. Pac-Man was introduced. And the candy Runtz came out in 1982.
Never a fan of Runtz.
I didn't mind them. I mean, usually only ate them around Halloween, but
yeah.
But those were some of the highlights from the year 1982.
All right. So did you do any digging on things you thought you wouldn't dig into, or?
I did. I mean, I didn't go down as deep as I did from the year before. The year before actually had, I think, a lot more good albums. There were a handful. Well, this is going back to the time where most bands, it seemed like, were putting out one album almost every year. So we had some albums, again, from bands that put out one in 1981, like Y&T. I thought their album Earthshaker from 81 was better from their album that they put out in 82, which I don't have right in front of me. I didn't write that one down. But and then we also had another release from, we had Ozzy put out another album in 82.
That was
82.
A live album, though.
Said
Speak
it?
Of the Devil, or what is it again? It's a live album, I believe, because I looked into that one. Because it has Iron Man and all the 70s shit Black Sabbath stuff on it.
Ozzy.
Sweet Leaf and War Pigs.
Isn't it right where I thought it would be in this list of stuff? But
thought it was Speak of the Devil.
Yeah, it probably was. But why isn't it with the O's? Oh, there it is. Yeah, Speak of the Devil. It is live. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yep, it was a live album. All right. Black Sabbath put out another album that year. They had one in 81 and 82. I mean, there were a lot of, again, and we talked about this offline, a lot of bands back then put out an album every year, which I don't know. I would like some band, I guess, bands to kind of go back to that. Maybe a year is too much, but it seems like now it's 7, 8 more before in between albums. And
Their music style changes so drastically over that amount of time, and you lose interest of new fans, and it's just not a good recipe.
Yeah, and I can't imagine that it's easy to, go out to promote your new album and then still find time to write well, your current album, I should say, and then still find time to write for a new album.
Right, but they did that for decades. I mean,
right, I get it, you know, but
and what you do, because a lot of these, it's not like they have a 10 albums or a 10 song album and that's all they wrote. They're writing 20, 30, 40 songs. You know, you could easily, you know, save some for the next. And
yeah, you have that. And of course, there's obviously a lot of that that does never gets released because it's just probably not good enough to make an album. But
the other thing is music didn't change overnight back then, right? I mean, what was good in the 70s, that style stayed for a decade. Same with the 80s. Nowadays, it's like, well, this kind of music's popular today, and now we're going to add auto tune. Now we're going to add this. Now, so your music true. Sounds dated immediately.
Yeah, very true. But yeah, so I can't even count how many albums came out that year, right? A lot of them. Oh, another one that, I mean, UFO had an album in 82 as well as 81, and I listened to that one. But again, I didn't go down a lot of these. I had heard the majority of them before. But
even for me, there may not have been a lot of great ones, but I did a little bit of listening. But there were some that were so strong, I had a hard time believing like somebody like a UFO or something was going to unseat some of these big ones. So,
okay.
So whoever wants to go.
Well, why don't you start us off? Tell us what you came up with.
Well, I'm going to give my honorables first.
All right.
And I picked out three. These are the ones I thought were the strongest for me, anyway, for my taste. And at number three is going to be the Scorpions' Blackout. Blackout's, of course, a great song. Can't Live Without You is still, you know, an epic song. I love that intro, as I think I mentioned. Maybe it was off air, maybe it was on the last episode. That's just one of the coolest, with that 1, 2, 3, 4 and kicking into that guitar riff. No One Like You is just a awesome, awesome song. When the Smoke Is Going Down, China White's pretty decent tune. It's just, it was a pretty strong, at least those Blackout, No One Like You, Can't Live Without You are just staples for Scorpions to this day. And I absolutely love those three songs. This is the album that made me really take notice of the Scorpions before Rock You Like a Hurricane.
Yeah. That album made my list also in the honorable mentions. They didn't crack my top three. But again, solid album, very good. You know, and I wasn't listening to the Scorpions in 82, but again, some of their classics came off that album. Strong competitor, very good. I liked it.
All right, you want to do your number three, or how many you got?
Well, I have some.
Why don't you just do an honorable mention first, and then
all right. Well, I have an honorable mention, and it's probably, I'm not even sure if you've heard of them. I just recently heard of them for the first time. And again, it's because of that vinyl group that I'm a part of on Facebook. But somebody was talking about a Canadian band by the name of Coney Hatch.
Never heard of it.
And they had their debut album in 82. And I will say, I mean, I put it up there as just an honorable mention because I think their other stuff, their, you know, after that was much better, but a solid debut album from a band that I don't think a lot of people have heard of, that made my list because it's a good listen. It's kind of generic, I would say, but that's just because I've listened to so much music in that same genre that you know, that is better. But I think for a debut album, they had for the Canadian charts, and I don't know how that would be compared to the US charts, that, I mean, they did have a song that reached number 19, that charted at number 19 off that album, so obviously they got some listen in their home country. But I thought it was a very good album. It's self-titled, Coney Hatch. So that was an honorable mention.
Really can't add nothing to that. I have not heard it. My number two honorable mention is going to be Screaming for Vengeance from Judas Priest. One of their best albums still to date for me. The Hellion is an amazing guitar intro, right? It's been used on commercials in modern day, leading right into Electric Eye, which is a killer tune. Take These Chains Off is an extremely underrated song. I mean, it's not a ballad really, but it's close. Screaming for Vengeance, great tune. Of course, the legendary Another Thing Coming. One of the first metal videos I ever saw on MTV. I'll never forget where that dude's walking down and his head blows up. It's the lasers coming through the band as they're playing. It just was an epic visual on top of the great song. And Devil's Child's a good song. My favorite Priest song to this day out of any album of any era, Fever. To me, one of it's a perfect song. I mean, it's got the mellow intro. It goes into the slight upbeat and that middle section where Halford's got a different verse and his voice is just up there in another stratosphere. That song just makes me amped every time I hear it. So
yeah, great album. I had that one much higher, right? That's not in my, I guess, honorable. I had that as my number two album from the year. So
which was my number two album.
Okay. I thought we were talking about ones that wouldn't have been in our top three. But yeah, I had that as my number two. It's an amazing album. And I know for 80, I think I put them up there for my number one album that year. Yeah, you've said it all. There's not much I can add to that. It's an outstanding listen.
It is fabulous. Timeless.
Very.
Then go ahead.
The album that I guess that I would have put at number three overall, and I don't want to say it's a stretch. It's definitely not hard as Judas Priest, but I put Night Ranger's Dawn Patrol.
Nice. Now, what was on that one?
Good question. That had... do I still have...
Sorry, my phone's going nuts.
That album has Don't Tell Me You Love Me.
Great
Sing
song.
Me Away. Yeah. I mean, obviously that's the biggest hit off that one. Sing Me Away, which I think is a phenomenal song. Eddie's coming out tonight. Young Girls in Love or Young Girl in Love. And then the Night Ranger by Night Ranger.
Such a good rock band. Such a good rock band.
Yeah. They've been around for a very long time. Yeah, it's so that's again, and it's more airplay kind of stuff. But
but they got a harder edge. I mean, especially coming up when you get into You Can Still Rock in America, and they got some harder stuff.
But yeah, so that's what I would have had at my third overall favorite album from that year.
And you put Scorpions at number two.
No, Scorpions would have been at four.
Or not Scorpions, Judas.
Judas Priest was at number two. Yeah.
Okay. And my first needs no introduction. To me, still the greatest rock metal album by anybody ever is Kiss's Creatures of the Night. And this has got very little to do with my bias towards Kiss. This is just that. It basically was the first of its kind, right? That big drum sound, which I believe they recorded by putting the drums down a hallway so it would echo all the way down. I mean, I wish they would have kept that sound. That was so different. Title track is amazing. Saint Gene really shines on this and Lick It Up. To me, his best stuff until maybe Revenge, but still better than Revenge's stuff. Saint and Sinner is unbelievable. I love Rock and Roll Hell. That's a great anthem. War Machine, Killer's a good tune. And Paul with Keep Me Coming, which is just stronger than hell. I Still Love You is a bluesy power ballad. Of course, you got I Love It Loud, another anthem off this thing. This is Danger's a great song by Paul. I love this whole album. The only one I skip once in a while is War Machine, and that's just because it's so overplayed through their set over the years. But I absolutely from the look of the cover, and I mean the original cover, not the non-makeup with, you know, the re-release, the blue face makeup. As a kid, just staring at that thing, their glowing eyes, it would just hypnotize you with that deep, dark sound. It's just an all-around epic experience to listen to that album.
Yeah, I too put this at the top of my list. And again, I don't know why too many people would argue against it, whether you're a lifelong Kiss fan or not. A lot of people, you know, reading some of the reviews of it, put this as like their comeback album.
Yeah.
I believe this was like their 10th studio. The 10th studio album. And The Elder, like we talked about in the last episodes, it's still my favorite Kiss album of all time, with Creatures being number two.
But fans, it was a lot like Extreme's Three Sides.
Exactly.
It was such a turn to the lighter, softer side that Kiss fans were like, what the fuck is this?
But even before The Elder, and you're definitely, the Kiss historian out of the two of us, but a lot of people were saying that they even slid into a little bit of a more disco style of groove before right. The Elder.
I would say Dynasty gets labeled by that just because of I Was Made for Loving You, which is really the only disco song on that album. Yes, there's a couple of softer ballads. For the most part, Dynasty is a solid rock and roll, not hard rock, just a rock and roll album. Unmasked is the more poppy. And I love that album too, but that one, I never understood why Dynasty got that, other than the I Was Made for Loving You disco hit. The rest of the album ain't like that. Obviously, Charisma. I mean, are you kidding me? I mean, there's some really strong stuff on there.
Yeah, Charisma. I love that song. Sure Know Times. Something. That's a little bit.
Yeah, I'm like I said, they got a couple ballads and some softer stuff, but Unmasked is the real one that I would say, not even disco. It's like bubblegum pop, but it's still good. But so, yeah. And then they faded into the concept album with The Elder. So for three albums, you're right. They kind of were like, the Kiss fans were checking out, the diehards that, you know, grew up with the heavy black and white Kiss. But that's why this was such a comeback album, because it just ripped your fucking face off after those three albums.
Yeah. Couldn't agree more. Like I said, you're definitely are more eloquent in speaking about that, about them than I am. But again, that's still the top of my chart. Other albums that I felt were worth mentioning, Aerosmith's Rock in a Hard Place came out that year. None of their big hits came off that album.
No, I get it, but I was way more, I wouldn't say fan, but I enjoyed Aerosmith much more in the 70s and early 80s before that Pump album, or whichever one had Love in an Elevator and Janie's Got a Gun and all that crap. When they became commercial, they became unlistenable for me. But like Back in the Saddle and Sweet Emotion and all this, you know, their 70s stuff was very, very good.
Sammy Hagar's Three Lock Box.
Yeah.
And then I know it's a band that I kind of rip on from time to time. And I don't think anything that we've ever done on air, but Cheap Trick's One-on-One came out that year. That has my all time favorite song from Cheap Trick on it. She's Tight.
That's their best song ever.
And so overall, and I want to say it has one of their big hits, and I have to go back to it.
Is a question for cheap trick historians out there. Is there a fucking version of I Want You to Want Me that's not live?
No, because I think I don't know if it's been published, but it's off their Live at Budokan album is the one that gets played all the time.
So they just had a song out of nowhere that everybody knew the words to all of a sudden because it had never been released. That don't make sense to me.
I remember watching something recently on YouTube about them on a channel that I subscribe to. And he had, like, they struggled early on. Now, they had some success, and then they had, like, two or three albums that faded. And then that Live at Budokan came out, and that is what all of a sudden everybody loved, right? I mean, that put them back on the map, and
It's kind of like Bob Seger. I can't find a version of Turn the Page that isn't fucking live.
Yeah, I'd have to look more into that, but I know that the one that gets played all the time is the one off of the Live at Budokan album. But they just also like
rock
had...
And, I was just wondering, because Rock and Roll Night, you'll only ever fucking hear from a live one. But it's there's a studio release of it, and I've just never been able to find that. Like I said, for Seegers or Cheap Tricks, it's always the live.
For that album, the one-on-one album from Cheap Trick, it also had If You Want My Love, which...
Now, that's a good song.
Yeah.
That I like. It's the surrender and the fucking... I want you to want me's, and I like Surrender the way Ransom did it when they beefed it up with that heavy drums and shit. They made it more metal. But the one that really fucking I just cannot listen to, and I'll turn it off immediately, is that fucking Dream Police. That is just a goddamn terrible song. I don't understand why that was ever released.
I'd have to.
And as far as I Want You to Want Me, it's kind of like Rock and Roll Night. Is I just heard it so goddamn much because it seems to be the only thing they've... How about some more Flame? I don't care what any Cheap Trick sound. That was a beautiful, beautiful ballad. Be Cruel, a great cover.
And I, again, watching that episode off of YouTube, the Flame, I mean, it was... since they were struggling with a couple of flopped albums, they brought in like five different songwriters to assist in trying to come up with content to
if they put wanted on an hits album. They should have just brought Desmond Child in. They'd have had a fucking platinum album.
Yeah, he was the master from that time period. But they almost didn't, the lead singer didn't like the Flame. I think it was the singer.
Robin Zander.
Zander. But it almost, they fought hard to not put it on the album, but it made it. And of course, that's
made the album.
Yeah.
It made them a huge fucking success.
Brought their career a little bit, prolong their career a little bit. But yeah, that was a good song.
Any other albums?
I think that sums up my list of the ones that I had written down. I think 83, we're going to get into a few more albums that are personal to me that are probably going to not necessarily top my list, but looking ahead, I saw an album that will probably make my top three, and it probably wouldn't even crack anybody else's top 50, but that's just me.
just looking through overall on some lists, it doesn't look like even in other genres there was a whole bunch.
Well, yeah, 38 Special Forces came out that year, and then TNT's self-titled album TNT came out, but that was with their original lead singer before Tony Harnell joined them.
Jeez, what a visionary. Neil Young came out with an album called Trans.
Vandenberg had an album that year, and it was okay. Like I said, so I did go listen to some of the ones I said I was going to. YNT's Black Tiger, like I said, I thought the Earthshaker was a better album, but still pretty good. So I listened to a couple of the songs off of the album from a band called Girl. I'm not sure if you've ever heard of them, but it contained Phil Collin from Def Leppard fame. So he was the guitarist, and the lead singer went on to front LA Guns.
Really?
Yes. And
Phil Lewis had another band?
Yep. Phil Lewis and Phil Collin. With a band called Girl. And like I said, I listened to that, and I want to say that there were a couple of other people and they may have gone and joined. Let's see what it says. They may have gone and joined LA Guns too, but let's see. So original members, Phil Lewis, Phil Collin, Jerry Laffey. Let's see what we can get about him, if anything. Played with the London Cowboys, Sheer Greed. So not him. Jonathan Trevisic on drums. Nothing else on him. Pete Barnacle.
So how was it? Did you listen to it at all?
It was okay. I mean, it was definitely.
Did Phil Lewis sound like Phil Lewis?
Yeah, he did. I mean, none of the songs were earth shattering, but you could definitely see a glimpse of what was to come from both Phil Collin and Phil Lewis. So yeah, it was good. I mean, not outstanding, but it was a decent listen.
Lighter side, it looks like the Go-Go's Vacation album came out.
Oh.
Fleetwood Mac's Mirage. Marvin Gaye, Rush, Signals, Elvis Costello. I never got that guy.
Michael Schenker Group had an album come out. I did listen to that one. It was okay. Not their best stuff, but it was still good.
Duran Duran's Rio.
Ooh. Man of War's Battle Hymns was a tough listen. an album from Mama's Boys, and I think we talked about this on a previous that album wasn't very good, but the one that I bought from that like antique store a couple weeks ago, it's good. I'm enjoying it. I can't find it on Spotify though.
Of course, Iron Maiden's Number of the Beast, didn't we? Did you say that already?
I mentioned that they put out an album in consecutive years.
The Clash's Combat Rock.
Yeah.
Big deal.
Of course, Saxon had another one.
Mentioned Prince and Michael Jackson. Yeah, so it really wasn't that eventful of a year. It was more eventful almost in rock than it was in pop.
Yeah, and like I know in our last episode, I mentioned how I liked the UFO album from that year. The one from 82
I did check them out, and I didn't go too deep into it, spend too much time on it, but they got a really good sound, so I'm going to keep revisiting that.
Yeah, and the 82 album, Mechanics, was, again, it was okay. They still sound like the stuff that I like, right? I mean, the type of music that I enjoy listening to the most, but it wasn't as good as the 81 album. Oh, can't forget Eldanova came out that year in 82
with Fantasy.
Yeah, I mean,
and a song that I think is in sadly underrated is That Fool in Yourself. Other than Fantasy, that song I just love.
Was that on that album too?
Yeah.
Yep, you're right.
Yeah, that Fantasy video was some cool shit too.
But yeah, those kind of sum up you know what, there was a album from Rose Tattoo,
okay,
that was also pretty good. Another band that I hadn't heard of before, but that was a pretty decent listen. But yeah, one of the things I found out about UFO is one of the bands that I enjoy from that time period. Actually, a couple of other bands that I enjoy from that time period have the same bassist. Pete Way was the bass player for UFO, and he's also the bass player for Fastway.
Really?
Yeah, so Fastway, the name of that band.
Simultaneously,
Well, Fastway's first album doesn't come out until 83.
Okay.
So I'm not sure if UFO breaks up at this point, because I don't know much about them. But Fastway's first album comes out. So the name Fastway comes from Fast Eddie Clark, who was a guitar player for Motorhead, and Pete Way. So they took the Fast and the Way and came up with Fastway.
Well, that's kind of cool.
There is also a band called Wasted,
Yep, I've heard of them.
Who
was the singer of that? I think it was someone who went on to do some major shit.
Just somebody by the name of Danny Vaughn.
There you go.
So, and Danny wasn't, Danny wasn't the original lead singer. Danny joined from 85 to 87.
I think that band has a lot of outlets because I keep hearing that in other band discussions to where some member was in and out of Wasted and this and that.
So here are some other names, and we'll see if you recognize this first one I'm going to say. Vinny, I think he pronounces his last name Vincent.
Oh, Poncia.
he was a guitar player for them from 96 to 98.
Late? Wait, after Vinnie Vincent Invasion?
Yep.
They were still going in the late 90s?
Yeah. Through the early 2000s. 2004 looks, or 2007 looks like their last.
I never knew Vinnie was in anything after the Invasion.
Joey Belladonna.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
Yep. He's been around. He was vocalist for Anthrax at one point. Let's see, Steve Harris. Let's see if Iron Maiden. He was in, I don't know if much about them. Jerry Shirley, Fastway, Badfinger, played with Sammy Hagar, Phil Filthy Animal Taylor on drums. I mean, this, so Neil Shepherd, Frank Noon, he also played with Def Leppard and a band called Roadhouse. Paul Martin Raymond played with Fleetwood Mac, and the Michael Schenker group, UFO. So yeah, this band had a lot of musicians that have been in and out of other bands as well. But
like, it was a staging area to keep warm until you found something else.
But again, I think this is Danny Vaughn's first. Well, I don't, not brainchild, because it was Pete Way that started the band. But I think it was his first front. I think it may be the first thing he ever, first he ever recorded with.
Gotcha.
Was Wasted before Tyketto. And he had some really good songs with Wasted.
Cool.
But yeah. So we'll see, because I think they're for, like I said, we got 85 to 87. So there should be a couple of albums from Wasted coming up that we'll have to give a listen to for those years.
Also in 82, I believe they put out Kiss Killers, mostly import. Of course, it was pretty much just a greatest hits compilation, but it did have four tracks, I'm a Legend Tonight, Down on Your Knees, Partners in Crime, and Nowhere to Run. All Paul Stanley songs, all phenomenal. They were all demoed to be on, Jesus, was it Creatures or The Elder? One of the two that didn't make the cut. And they should have.
Probably should have.
Yeah. I mean, they're great songs, but again, it was an official Kiss release, but it was kind of like in the background of Creatures and everything else. I think it came out later as an attempt to get the popularity back with another greatest hits type thing.
Another one of your favorite bands put out their final studio album that year. Sweet released Identity Crisis in 82.
It's sad what they became. I think by then Connolly was gone. Steve Sweet was doing a lot of the lead vocals, or not, Steve Priest, I'm sorry, was doing a lot of the vocals. They completely lost their way for me in the late 70s, early 80s. But yeah, great band in their heyday.
All right. Anything else you want to talk about?
Other than that, Paul Stanley's back up and rolling. The band had to cancel three shows, two in Canada, one in Indianapolis, I think, because he had the flu. There's pictures he posted out on his social media of him in the hotel room with an IV bag, really bad flu. And of course, there's no time to make these shows up. The end date is the 2nd of next month. So sucks for those fans, but I watched a sound check of them today on the stage, and he looked great. He's running around and all smiles. So hopefully the rest of the shit goes off without a hitch. They're doing their last show streaming live on pay-per-view, and I'm not a big guy for that, but I think I will do that just so I can, you know, you can wait till the fucking Blu-ray comes out or whatever, but just kind of cool to see it live. I'm just curious to see if they do anything to really commemorate the end, because like I said, I went to the end of the road show and it was an awesome show, but there was nothing that would tell you that's the end. I mean, they didn't really do anything to, you know, to make it stand out that, hey, this is the last time, other than, you know, hey, this is our last time here. And this, and other than that, there's nothing really. It's just a Kiss show. So I'm curious. Obviously, the ship has sailed and getting Peter and Ace, but maybe Bruce comes out, or I don't know.
Well, there's been rumors. I mean, I know that it was Paul that shot down the notion of them doing like a residency at the Sphere in Vegas. But there was some sort of recent interview that Gene gave that he hinted at that this end of the road stuff would be the last stuff in makeup. So there might be the possibility of some shows, whether it be a
acoustic thing or
something like, yeah,
some jams, maybe not, here or there.
Yeah. And where they're,
he also made reference of having like 10 different touring bands in different locations. I think that's great, but that's not going to sell.
I was going to say, what would be your take on, let's say, you know, Paul and Gene stopped, but they went forward with Tommy and Eric?
Eric Singer.
And then either fill in or, you know, some sort of rotation or some other permanent people to take over Paul and Gene's spot. And a band by the name of Kiss continued to tour. What would your thought on that be?
No interest. Kiss is and always has been Paul and Gene. I'm not a tribute band guy. I went to Hairball, bored the shit out of me. If it's not real, it's not real. I went to Sweet just to say I could see Sweet when Steve Priest was still alive. They continue without him. I have no interest. If I see Sweet again, it'll be because I get the shot to see Andy Scott's version. You got to have something original there. And Eric and Tommy, I love, but that's not Kiss. They're just guys. I'm sorry. Right. Ace and Peter were just guys. I mean, since the 70s, you know, in the early 70s, the imagery, if you look at the imagery and everything, but you take Ace and Peter out of there for their contributions to the albums, and all the hit songs are still Paul and Gene. The essence of that band is Paul and Gene. So I would have no interest. I wouldn't have a problem with it, but I have no interest in it anymore than I want to go see some of these Kiss tribute bands in a bar somewhere. Couldn't care less.
Yeah, I mean, they're definitely not tribute. I mean, it wouldn't necessarily be.
It's supposed to be Kiss.
Talented musicians, right?
But it's not Kiss. You can't recast all of Judas Priest and say, here, this is Judas Priest for the next 20 years. No, it's not.
I know. The only reason why I ask is there's, you know, some people have thrown that around saying, yeah, you know, a band like Kiss should never go away, right? They should continue in some way, shape, or form. And whether that's people who have been in the band before, whether it's Bruce or...
Oh, shit, dude. We got less than a minute here.
All right. Well,
let's do this. Fun. We'll do a Kiss one.
Okay.
All right. And I think we just lost our recording.
Well, it didn't say anything on my end yet.
No, it still says less than 1 minute. Anyway.
Right. Thanks, we'll everybody. Wrap it up. If you watched, enjoy. We'll take care.
We'll see you on 1983.
All right.
Bye.
Bye.